thank you everybody for coming. It means a lot. It means a lot to the family. And we're just going to spend some time celebrating Keith. He was such a blessing and a great guy, and he will be missed. He is loved. Keith had a lot of notes in his Bible, and he had a list in the back of some songs he wrote down. Thank you, Mom. And I'm not sure when he wrote these down or why, but this hymn was one of those songs. So if you know it, you can sing along. You don't have to. God sent his son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. Then one day, and then one day, I'll cross the river. I'll fight life's fight, no war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the light and glory, and I know he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know and life is worth the living just because he lives. And life is worth the living just because he lives.
Amen. Appreciate that, Corey. And again, as Corey mentioned, that was one of the songs. It was one of the very last things he wrote in his Bible. He listed four songs, and that was one of those songs. I just want to say on behalf of Patty and all of Keith's family, I know they appreciate everybody being here. And if you knew Keith at all, and I'm assuming all of us knew Keith, he was certainly a little bit out of the box. And so this won't be a normal funeral, all right? But as I've had the privilege of being a pastor and friend to them, Keith always sat way up there in the cheap seats, all right, up there in the balcony. And all this time, I thought he wasn't paying attention. But I got his Bible. Patty let me take his Bible. And I just want to tell you, Patty, I think I've told you this personally. In my 45 years in pastoring, this is one of the greatest Bibles I've ever had a chance to go through. I mean, from beginning to end, he had stuff marked. He had cards put in there. I mean, it took me hours just to kind of go through the Bible and just to spend some time. I really appreciate. So much of what I am going to say today is what he wrote down in his Bible. So he really is going to get the last word. All right. So Keith is going to get the last word. And so again, we appreciate you being here. I want to begin by just sharing a couple posts that Keith had over the last year or so. And if my clicker's working, this was in July of last year. He said, he got a black eye there. Special thank you to Beth Newbold for my free cancer cut. I'm Sorry, I question your motives of punching me in the right eye to toughen me up for my chemo and radiation treatments, but you were right. You are now part of God's plan to rid me of this disease. Also, a shout out to my Orioles for winning 10 in a row. And so that's just kind of the who Keith was, just kind of a little bit again. And this is a picture of he and Patty at the game. Happy birthday to my awesome wife, Patty. I still wouldn't be on the planet without her. When I start feeling sorry for myself, it reminds me that I still owe the good Lord for putting her into my life. And so you guys actually met at work. And so you were in the office, and he would bring you files. Instead of bringing all the files at once, he brought you one at a time, one at a time. And so he just kind of drug that out. And I know people at work said, not a good idea. Not a good idea to date somebody at work. But I just want to tell you, who would have ever dreamed that you met Mr. Wright and that he really did and was the right person for you? A couple months later on Facebook, up into October, he really had this picture, 8-0 with the goat helmet, Bobby T. And so standing in front of his TV. How many of you knew that he was a Clemson fan? I see a lot of Clemson shirts, all right? A lot of different shirts, all right? And then a couple days later, Drew took him down to the hockey game. Well, I guess Drew got the old man some good seats before my surgery on 11-3. Ha! And all you can eat and drink also. And so he was enjoying that. So I don't know how you pull that off, but I know he that really meant a lot to him. And as I was talking to Patty, she said his life verse was in 1 Corinthians. It's actually on his memory card, if you got a memory card. But his life verse is do everything in love. And this is his handwriting. He wrote better than almost anybody. He had great handwriting. So he wrote at the top of that page, do everything in love. And then he has brackets around not just verse 14, but 13. Be on your guard, stand firm in faith. Be men of courage, be strong, and then verse 14, do everything in love. That was his life verse, to give back along the journey. And if you've ever been to their house, as you're going out the door, he had this right above the handle. Right above the handle, there's a little sticker that says, I must not think bad thoughts, I must not think bad thoughts, I must not think bad thoughts. How many of you know he went out with a positive attitude every day? And right above that sticker, in the middle of the door, just above that, he had, be thankful always. He really did live a life of joy. I mean, I just want to say the privilege of knowing Keith, he always seemed to be happy. He always seemed to be joyful. But he always started out with a reminder every day, because sometimes we need those reminders. One other verse I want to give you here at the beginning, and this was, again, he put big dark brackets around it in his Bible, and it's Psalms 39, verses 4 and 5. And so I put the scripture here to the right, just so it would be a little bit easier to read. And if you don't mind, let's just read it together. This is out of his Bible that he bracketed. It says, show me, O Lord, my life's end and the number of my days. Let me know how fleeting is my life. You have made my days a mere handbreadth, and the span of my years is as nothing before you. Each man's life is but a breath. And so let's take a moment and pray together. After the prayer, Jared's going to come and share, and then after he shares, Corey's going to come and sing again. We really appreciate you guys. I know Keith would be really very, very, very proud that you guys are a big part of this, and so I thank you for doing that. Let's pray together. Father, I just want to thank you for just an amazing day. And Lord, even though there's so many things that, Lord, I don't understand, there's a lot of why questions that I have. And one of those is the suffering that Keith had to go through, and Lord, being taken at such a young age. But Lord, we trust your goodness. And Lord, we know you know everything that we're going through. Nothing takes you by surprise. And so, Father, I just pray that today it would be a celebration of this incredible life you gave some 59 plus years ago. I pray a special prayer for Patty and other members of the family. Father, just love on them in a special way as we gather here today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Some notes, and then afterward I typed them up, and these are just some thoughts I had about it.
Let me get you a mic. That's not working, and I want everybody to be able to hear you. Yeah.
All right, now you have to listen to me. I just have some thoughts that I wrote down about Uncle Keith. Growing up as a kid, I adored Uncle Keith. I recall being bored on any given Saturday, and my parents would want to stay home and take a nap, something I now understand now that I have children. Uncle Keith would come and pick us up and take us to Chesterfield Mall or bowling. Corey and I thought we were pretty cool, getting to go somewhere without our parents. And as you all know, Keith always had to be doing something. Uncle Keith took us to our first blues game, but he always tended to go a little overboard, so he signed us up for the Junior Blues Notes fan club, and we got some exclusive souvenirs from it. And I ate too much cotton candy, I guess, because in the parking lot on the way home, I opened the door and I threw up. And then Andrew, after he watched me, opened his door and he threw up. And then poor Corey was in the middle between two pukers. Uncle Keith had this tradition with my mom and aunt that they always had to fight about who paid the restaurant bill. So when he would lose, he would secretly give Corey and I cash to hide in our parents' van. We thought that was pretty fun, being secret agents for our uncle. Uncle Keith never missed our birthday. Sometimes he even bought us two cards because he couldn't decide on just one. And he would always decorate them with stickers and fill them with the worst confetti he could find so that they would burst out all over the carpet, much to my mother's dismay. I remember one birthday we were driving home and we passed him walking on Highway 100. And when we arrived at our house, we found he had taped a happy birthday banner to our garage door. I don't know why he didn't drive, but he walked 4 miles to do it. We thought that was pretty cool. Even at age 34, he always bought us a card and a gift. In many ways, I turned out just like my uncle. We both write in all capital letters. His handwriting is unmistakable, and frankly, it's really good. It could be its own font. We both had Osgood Schlatter disease in one knee. One bone sticks out too far, and it gives you this weird bump that it hurts sometimes. And I got it in eighth grade, and I was really self-conscious about it. He made me feel better, though. He showed me his, and it was much worse, and he bragged that it was the worst case his doctor had ever seen. He was proud of it for some reason. We both have amalgam dental fillings. Okay, I know this is stupid, but it's funny the things you notice and latch on to as a kid, because I always noticed the black splotches in his mouth, and I assumed he didn't take good care of his teeth, but I never asked him about it because I didn't want to embarrass him. It wasn't until I was 30 years old and I got my first filling that I went home and looked in the mirror, and to my horror, I realized I was wrong about him. I never told him about that, though. We both were probation and parole officers. I remember calling him when I was in college and I had decided to switch my major to criminal justice, and he tried to talk me out of it. But I wouldn't listen, so he helped land me an internship and then a job with the state. I worked in the field office, but sometimes I would get to come to the prison to run a special program. I'd come early to see him, and I wish you all could have seen his cubicle. Have you ever watched a nature documentary where a bird is making a nest? They take each twig and they place it lovingly and caringly in a specific spot. Well, that was Uncle Keith's cubicle. Every square inch was covered with sports memorabilia, knickknacks, stickers, buttons, signs. It was honestly its own work of art. We were both Pittsburgh Steelers fans. He spent the first years of my life buying me Steelers merchandise and recruiting me as a fan. And then he spent the rest of my life convincing me the NFL's rigged and that he could predict, based on the betting odds, what was going to happen. And he was usually right. I never got to go to a game in Pittsburgh with him, but we did go to a Rams game when they were playing the Steelers. And I really missed the Rams because they were so bad and the tickets were so cheap. But that game did feel like a Pittsburgh game, though, because three quarters of the stadium were all Steelers fans, and the streets outside were even selling Steelers gear. I kind of felt sorry for the Rams. Uncle Keith was a haggler, as you guys all know, and he had a way with words and people and talking people into things, so he called the front office and got them to let us hold the American flag down on the field for the pregame. He tried to do it in a Pittsburgh jersey, though, and they made him put a Rams jersey on. We both were Misha basketball referees. He talked me into doing it, and he reffed lower-level games with me for a few years to help teach me. I honestly was never a huge fan, and I just did it for extra money, but Uncle Keith loved it. When a coach would cuss at him, he would just crack a joke and make them laugh. He always knew the perfect quip to say to a player to make them smile. And he would sometimes carry packs of trading cards in his pocket and hand them out to kids in the stands. I mean, who does that? He was really special. We both had a love for softball, and he was really stinking good. The last time I played with him, he could barely jog because his knees hurt so bad. So he just hit it over the fence instead. And of course, he played catcher and had the umpire and the batters laughing the whole time with his heckling. We both loved to cook, but he was much better than me. Anything Uncle Keith made was always delicious. We both loved to tell jokes and make people laugh in awkward or sad or angry situations. It's a defense mechanism, I know, and sometimes not an appropriate response, but it usually helps put everyone at ease. Uncle Keith was the funniest person I know. My favorite joke of his came in the balcony at church during a rather humdrum rendition of I'd Rather Have Jesus. The second verse begins with the phrase, I'd rather have Jesus than men's applause. But Uncle Keith would always sing, I'd rather have Jesus than menopause. So I still sing that to this day. There are, of course, some things that Uncle Keith surpassed me at. He had a green thumb and loved to garden. His apartment's porch and breezeway were always covered in plants. It looked like a retired old lady lived there. Uncle Keith was a masterful storyteller. I remember being at family events and being upset if I heard Uncle Keith telling a story in the other room and I had missed the beginning of it. He could take the most mundane event and turn it into a side-splitting tale of adventure. Uncle Keith was a wonderful gift giver. In fact, sometimes I wondered if he only reffed and umpired so that he had extra money to buy gifts for people. Sometimes they were serious gifts, but the funny ones were my favorite. My wife and I got married 2.5 years ago, and I want to show you what he bought us for a wedding present. This is Santiago. One of his arms fell off last night. I'll have to glue it back on. And it came with this note. I'm going to read it to you. Jared and Haley Hogan. From the makers of Elf on a Shelf, we bought you Santiago for your house. Down through the ages, Santiago has brought good luck and longevity to all marriages. Santiago must be prominently displayed in your home throughout the year, preferably in your living room. Please send us a photo on our phones when Santiago finds his permanent spot in your home. Love, Uncle Keith and Patty. And Haley made me put it downstairs. I still bother her about that. Sometimes, Uncle Keith would turn one of his gifts into a tradition. Over the years, he's bought me about 8 Steelers ornaments. Corey has Star Wars ornaments. For Andrew's wife, Mallory, he decided on Black Santa ornaments. And I'm not talking 1 or 2. There has to be like 10 of various sizes. And if you've never met Mallory, she is the sweetest, most quiet person, and she didn't know quite how to take it. For a few years, she would try to hang them on the back of the tree. But Uncle Keith wouldn't allow it. What's wrong with the ornaments I bought you? He would heckle. Do you have something against Black Santas? He was just being ridiculous, of course. He didn't mean anything by it. And now Mallory has learned her lesson, and they are displayed prominently on the front of the tree. I'll finish with this. Uncle Keith had a big heart. I know he visited many of you when you were sick or needed a friend. My wife and I, we began fostering a 1-year-old boy 14 months ago, and Uncle Keith would always ask to babysit. And I never wanted to ask him because he had brain cancer, for crying out loud, and I didn't want to burden him, but he and Patty insisted. He loved Grayson when he didn't have to, and that meant the world to me. And lastly, I remember sometime in college, he gave me a card with a heartfelt note inside that said he was very proud of the man I had become. And that meant so much, because your parents, they have to be proud of you, right? But uncles don't. I know he wasn't perfect, but in many ways, I wanted to be just like him. He was a wonderful uncle, and I'll miss him very much. And I have one last story that Andrew asked me to share. Keith was a big Clemson fan, as you guys know, and Andrew would watch games with him, and whenever Clemson would score a touchdown, Keith would say, Alexa, play Hold That Tiger, which is the Clemson fight song. One day, Alexa accidentally played Hold That Tiger by the Mills Brothers instead, and they're like some ragtime band from the 30s. So from then on, Keith would always say, Alexa, play Hold That Tiger, and Andrew would chime in, by the Mills Brothers. So in honor of Keith, Alexa, play Hold That Tiger. Enjoy. I'm sure that song was very trendy when it first came out. I had to download it off YouTube and I could not make it through it, so it's ridiculous. I had the honor to officiate Keith and Patty's wedding, and it was probably one of the best weddings because I think I preached for like 10 minutes. It was done in 10 minutes, so. But it was such an honor to do it, and a special day, and Patty, when you said your vows, you meant it. Keith was blessed to have you as a wife, for sure. You took care of him until the end, and we love you for it. We miss him. We love him. But we have a hope because we have a Lord that is more powerful than death, and we're thankful for that. So we wanted to play one last song. You might know it, so if you know it, sing along. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship your holy name. Strength is failing, the end draws near, and my time has come. Still, my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. So bless the soul, worship his holy.
Appreciate that. I want to say to Patty, I appreciate you letting me wear one of Keith's jerseys, and I'm really glad he's not a medium, all right? That really did mean a lot, so I appreciate that. Now, one of the things that Keith did, I didn't really know this till just recently, but they would always sit up in the balcony over on this side, and everybody told me later that during church, while I was preaching, he was passing out candy to everybody. I did not know that. I wonder why everything was kind of excited up there. But anyway, so in honor of Keith, I brought some candy, and I'm going to pass out some candy today, all right? So I think we got a few guys that are going to come and help us, all right? We got some offering plates full of candy. Don't put anything in, but you can take out up to three pieces, all right? Up to three pieces. So if you guys will come down to the front, we're going to start at the front and just pass them back. And so enjoy in honor of Keith, all right? So we appreciate it. You know, when Keith was born in 1963, he's experienced a lot. When he was born, John F. Kennedy was president. By the way, Kennedy was assassinated when Keith was 3 weeks old, just really about 3 weeks old. The average annual income in the U.S. in 1963 was just under $6,000 a year. Gallon of gas was 29 cents. A new house back in 1963 was $12,500. It was in 1963 that zip codes were implemented. And the Beatles had their very first album released, Please, Please Me. 1963 is when Fruit Loops cereal went on sale. And I am told that there is no fruit in Fruit Loops, all right? But anyway, kind of interesting. Others born in 1963, Michael Jordan, Whitney Houston, Charles Barkley, all right? So just to give you an idea, he's experienced a lot in his 59 years. This is a little retro picture here of Keith. He was 13 years old. This was in his Bible. And again, I appreciate Patty letting me look through his Bible. He had more cards in his Bible. I think he set a Guinness World Record. I think every other page was a card. And this is what it looked like. I just kind of laid them all out. 44 cards he had in his Bible. And some go all the way back to 1993, a card that his mother had given him. So that's how far back. If you gave him a card, chances are it was in his Bible somewhere. So I just spent literally just hours looking through that particular thing. Now, Keith, we all know him by different things. He was a man of many interests, and there's a lot of things we knew him by. But there's one thing I found in the cards that you sent him, Patty. I didn't know, I've never heard him called in the middle of the heart there, Kiefer. And so you would address him as my Kiefers. And I don't know if I was supposed to say that. That was maybe probably a private name, but it will stay among us and our Facebook family, all right? But anyway, so those are just some of the things. He was a man that really had a lot of just impact on a lot of people around him. He obviously was a Clemson fan. He had a cat named Clemson. And so this is a picture of him and his cat. And right above it is a bird picture. And I asked Patty, how in the world did he talk you into letting him put that picture up? But he must have had some pull, and Patty had to have a lot of grace. So he put that picture up. And this is his Clemson's cat house. It's in, and man, he just went all out for his cat, as he does for most things in life. So in his Bible, I just want to share a few things that he wrote down in his Bible. In the book of Ecclesiastes, as Solomon was trying to find out what life was all about, and I think all of us have a step back and we ask ourselves, what is life about? What is the meaning of life? And certainly as we come to a time like this, it's a time to step back and just ask, what is the real purpose of life? Well, this is the exact page out of his Bible. He has written on the top, God plus nothing equals a fulfilled life. You know, Solomon really discovered that really the thing that really brings happiness is a relationship with God. And boy, that's really important. He also wrote down in the middle column there of his Bible, all the money and wealth will not make you happy or full. And then he has down on the bottom part of that, and I give you the words out here, I denied myself nothing my eyes desired. Everything was meaningless, a chasing after the wind. I thought it was interesting because in life, sometimes we try to accumulate more stuff. But I think we all realize that it isn't how much stuff we have that makes life valuable. It's the life that we live. And I think the value of Keith's life was not how much stuff he accumulated. I'm 45 years old, been in the ministry 45 years. I'm actually 66 years old. But I've never seen a U-Haul being taken to the cemetery. You know, the truth is, everything we have is temporary. Everything we have, we're going to leave behind. And I think if Keith could come back, one of the things he would say to us is, don't spend all of our life just trying to accumulate more stuff, thinking that somehow that that's going to make us happy. Because again, nothing wrong with having stuff, but I think we would all agree that stuff doesn't really make us happy. So I really appreciate that. And I was impressed as a pastor. He had four copies of the bridge illustration in his Bible, and they were all filled out. And so I would do the bridge illustration every couple years. So he had about 8 years worth of notes in his Bible. All this time I thought he was not paying attention up there, and he had every single one completely filled out. I was pretty impressed, and I'm going to have to apologize to him when I get to heaven. I didn't think he was paying attention. But I want to give you, this is one of them that he had in his Bible, and I love how he put in the middle there, Christ died for Keith. He really personalized it. And you know, I want to tell you, it's one thing to know that Jesus died for us, but when we can put our name there and realize that God loved us so much that he sent his son to die on the cross so that one day you and I can spend an eternity with him. And so when I read this, boy, I just spent some time just thinking about, again, this bridge illustration that sin has separated us from God, and we deserve to stay separated from God, but that God loved us so much, he sent his son to die on the cross so that you and I can have eternal life. And so again, I was just impressed that he had four of these filled out. And not only did Jesus die, not only was the fact that he was buried, but the fact that he rose again. Here in Mark chapter 16, he has the whole part of this chapter highlighted. That's the resurrection of Jesus. And he has written up at the top, Jesus risen, with an exclamation mark. And I just want to say, if Keith could come back, and I believe that everyone, if they could come back, you know, the Bible gives a story of a man who died and so desperately wanted to come back to his family. And this was a person that did not have a relationship with God. But I believe that every person, if they could come back, I believe they would come back and they would want to say to their family, first of all, I know Keith would say, I love you so much, man. I love you. He would say to all of his family, I love you. But I think he would say to all of us, that God loves you, that God loves you so much that he was willing to die on the cross so that we could spend an eternity with him. And there's not a Baptist way and a Methodist way and a Catholic way. The Bible says there's one way, and that's through Jesus Christ. I tell our church sometimes, we're Baptists here, I tell our church, some of you are going to be surprised when you get to heaven, find out God's not Baptist. He's not Methodist, Catholic, or Charismatic. He's God. But the one way to heaven is through Jesus Christ. And I can't think of anything sadder today than if someone were to leave this room not knowing that they knew Jesus as their Lord and Savior. One day there's going to be a reunion on the other side. I mean, this is not the end. You know, Jesus told his disciples, I'm going to prepare a place. One day there's going to be a reunion on the other side. I'm just telling you, we're not saying goodbye to Keith. We're saying so long. In a blink of an eye, we're going to be on the other side. And how sad it would be if one person in this room wasn't at that reunion because they got so busy in life, they put off the most important decision, and that's knowing Jesus. And so I want to say, as I went through his Bible, I had a revival in my heart. I'm telling you, I just sat there and wept as I went through his Bible. I mean, I had no idea he was paying attention all those Sundays. I mean, I had no idea. But he actually wrote down some of these things. He even actually wrote down on a piece of paper kind of his testimony as a Christian. He said, I am adopted into God's family, Galatians 4. I have unlimited wisdom through the Holy Spirit. I have the mind of Christ, again, through the Holy Spirit. And then from Colossians 2:10, I am complete with Christ. I want to tell you, that's the declaration of every believer in Christ. And as I was reading that stuff, I mean, I was amazed at all the things and the depth of things that he had written in his Bible. And one of the things that Keith, he loved children. And how many of you know children know fake when they see it? I mean, children are very, very real. I think Art Linkletter said, children are funny because they don't know what they're saying. Old people are funny because we don't care what we're saying. But you know, children have such a transparent way of seeing everything in life. Many of you know Darren Perkins, who lives here in Franklin County. His dad passed away, and they were trying to explain to his young niece that Grandpa took a trip to heaven. And so after the funeral, the young niece was riding home with grandma. And the young niece, in only a way that a child can, the young niece looked up at her grandma and said, "Grandma, didn't grandpa look so handsome in that big suitcase for his trip to heaven?" I want to tell you, when Keith said goodbye to us on June 10th, and I want to echo what the guy said, Keith was blessed to have so much family and so much love in these last couple years. I don't understand cancer. I don't. Our family lost a 3-year-old niece to brain cancer. I'm just telling you, there's a lot of things I don't understand. But I know that God is a good God. And I know that Keith was so blessed to have his family surrounding him. I was there at the hospital one time when Andrew was there, and Andrew was showing no mercy. I mean, and that's the way Keith would have been, if you know Keith. But we were there, and he had his helmet on, you know, his helmet on his head, and it had the Clemson emblem there. And I remember Andrew said something like, "Come on, man, quit faking it, get up." I'm thinking, you know, and so, but I mean, that's what his dad would have wanted. I mean, that's who his dad was. But he was surrounded in the last couple years with the people that really loved him. And I just want to, again, commend the family. I know many of you, it was a small army of people. I wish I could say that everybody died being surrounded by that kind of love, but it's not always true. And so I just want to really thank you for your faithfulness to him. And I know you had so many opportunities to express your love. And I know that he felt that intensely in those last moments. And so one of the things, he liked children. So in Matthew 18, he had this underlined in his Bible about them asking, "Who's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" And Jesus answered, "It's a child." I wish he would have said a Baptist preacher. I would have really been excited. But he took a child and he said, "This is what's great in God's eyes," because children are so innocent, so transparent. And he wrote in the column of his Bible there, he wrote the word child in the acrostic, carefree, humble, innocent, laughter, dependence. He understood that childlike faith, and just again, accepting Christ into our life, not because we deserve it, not because we've earned it, but with that childlike faith, receiving what Christ has done for us. He also had this in his Bible I thought was interesting, what to do if you miss the rapture. All right, what to do if Christ comes back and you miss the rapture? This is what he wrote in his Bible. Don't try to explain it away. Number 2, don't look for any Christians. Number 3, don't take the mark of the beast, 666. And number 4, don't expect to escape a martyr's death. You will be killed. I'm telling you, that is pretty heavy stuff right there. I've seen a lot of Bibles. I mean, man, he really laid out some things, I mean, that really would have... that can preach. I mean, I just really appreciate his heart. And then in Revelation 19, this is near the end, of course, of the Bible, but he has down a time to shout. And as they're seeing right after the tribulation and all the hell on earth, in heaven, from heaven's side, heaven is going to rejoice. Heaven is going to be shouting, because in the end, I just want to tell you, Christians win. God's people win in the end, and I love how he wrote there, a time to shout. And I think as Jared said, he always wrote in capital letters. It says, I heard, verse 6 there, I heard what sounded like a great multitude, like a roar of rushing waters, like loud peals of thunder shouting, "Hallelujah, for the Lord God Almighty reigns." I want to do something today I've only done in one funeral in my 45 years. And it's who Keith is. Keith is, he was a cheerleader. He was all out. He was 100%. I want us to do a Jesus cheer today, all right? I've only done it one time at a funeral. It may not seem like it applies. But I just want to tell you, on the other side, we're going to be shouting that name. We're going to be shouting the victory that's Christ. Now, he reffed a lot of games. He heard a lot of cheers. And the only way I know how to do a cheer is back in high school. I'm going to say, "Give me a J." You all are going to say, "It's been a while since high school, hasn't it?" All right. But anyway, you got to really, this is for Keith, all right? All right, if it was for me, it's for Keith. So I want you to give me your best you have, whatever that is. And in high school, we always went up, never go out, all right? Don't go out, but always go up. Very, very important, all right? So we're just going to do a Jesus cheer, because I want to tell you, folks, in the end, if you read the end of the story, Jesus wins. Everything he went through was so that you and I could spend an eternity with him. And it's worth shouting out that name. All right, y'all ready? How many of you are still glad you came? All right, still glad you came? All right, if you have a piece of candy in your mouth, spit it out or put it in your hand. I don't want it to go outward, all right? All right, so let's do it. Ready? Give me a J.
J.
That was really good. That almost surprised me, all right? I apologize, but that was really good. Give me a J.
J.
Give me an E.
E.
Give me an S.
S.
Give me a U.
U.
Give me an S.
S.
What's its spell?
Jesus.
Who's King of Kings?
Jesus.
Who's Lord of Lords?
Jesus.
Who died on the cross for our sin?
Jesus.
Who's coming back one day?
Jesus.
The Bible says there's no other name given under heaven whereby we must be saved. The Bible says one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. I can't think of a better tribute to Keith's life than to make sure that we have a relationship with Jesus. And when Keith said goodbye to us on June 10th, I believe that next instant he was saying hello to Jesus. The Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. I know this sounds really crazy at a funeral service, but Keith is more alive today than ever. And I can only imagine what it was like back on June 10th when he stepped into the presence of Jesus. I mean, he sat through a lot of boring sermons right here. But to see Jesus face to face, wouldn't you love to be a fly on the wall and just see Keith standing before Jesus and still has the marks of Calvary? I want to tell you, it wouldn't surprise me if these many days later, he's still standing there with his jaw dropped open. And again, if he could come back, he would say to all of us, Jesus loves you so much. You were worth Calvary. You were worth Calvary just so that we could spend an eternity with God. I know he would want us. And by the way, you guys really did amazingly well. This is on the inside cover of his Bible. It's a Jesus sticker. He put it right on the inside cover of his Bible and has the Hebrew name Yeshua there, the Hebrew for Jesus. Right off the bat, going through his Bible, I saw the name Jesus. And there is something powerful about that name, and it does bring life. I love how he wrote in the maps in the back. You know, most people don't write under the maps because nobody looks back there, but I was looking through his whole Bible. So I was looking through the maps, and he wrote down here, your reward is the Lord. I thought about what the writer of Hebrews said in Hebrews 11:6, God rewards those who diligently seek him. You know, if you're seeking something, your reward is finding what you're seeking for, right? And so if you're seeking the Lord, I think Keith understood that really the reward in life is finding God. It's finding that relationship with Jesus Christ. That really is the jewel that we're all looking for. And finally, in Revelation 22, this is the very last chapter of the Bible, he said at the top, whoever is thirsty for God, and he put a square around verse 17. We often refer to this as the great invitation. The Spirit and the bride say, come. Let him who hears say, come. And whoever thirsty, let him come. And whoever wishes, let him take the free gift of the water of life. Before the Bible ends, one last time, God says to people, he gives one last invitation that if you're thirsty, if there's something missing in your life, and you're trying to fill it with all kinds of stuff, the one thing that will really, truly satisfy your life is a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And then at the very bottom, this is the very last verse of the Bible, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with God's people. Amen. I think I got two more slides. This was the very last thing he wrote in the very last page of his Bible. He wrote down four hymns, which I shared with Corey. And right under that, this was the last thing that he wrote in his Bible. He said, tombstone, end of construction, thank you for your patience. How many of you know that he was a kind of a mess at times? He was a work in progress. And we are all a work in progress, and our work is finished is when we step to the other side. So if I were kind of picturing his tombstone, it would be this. Whoop, I went back. Sorry about that. Keith Wright, end of construction. Thank you for your patience. I think he would tell everybody, hey, thanks for hanging in there with me while I was a work in progress. My very last slide, words that he said to Patty. Pretty much near the end, he said to Patty, promise me Don't ever give up on God. Wow. Because I want to tell you, you're at a fork in the road and you can be very bitter to God. And in the natural realm, I would understand that. But I believe he wants us all to finish strong. I can't think of a more appropriate way to celebrate his life than to so live for Christ every day. That one day, Patty, when you step over to the other side, after spending maybe a few hundred years at the feet of Jesus, I hope Keith finds you and Andrew. I hope he says to both of you, you finished strong. You made me proud. I believe he would want us to finish strong. I think he would want us to live every day to the very fullest. I want to close with this, and then we're going to have a prayer. I always like to give something to the family, and he was a gardener, as was mentioned earlier. And these are some forget-me-not flower seeds that you can actually plant in memory of someone. And so on the back is a label with Keith's name and a picture of Keith. And it says his date of birth, November 1st, 1963, and then June 10th, 2023. And from this side, June 10th will always be remembered as his day of death. But from the other side, June 10th will always be remembered as his day of birth in eternity. So I want to tell you, he's alive and well, and he left us an unbelievable amount of information in his Bible to encourage us. I could do a 5-part series on just his Bible. I may need to borrow and just preach out of his Bible. I mean, it's fantastic. So on behalf of Keith, I've got 7 of these, I believe. You can give them to your family, and we have other. If we can make others if we need to. I want us to join together. Can we all, I hope you got a memory card. If you got a memory card, put it somewhere. You'll see it every day for 30 days or so. And can we all join together every day and pray for Patty, pray for Andrew? Let's join together as family and friends and just pray for them, because your difficult days are still coming ahead. But we just want to surround you with love. And we want to support you and just want you to finish strong. And so again, on behalf of Keith, I know he appreciates everybody here. There was a line of people for 3 hours coming through here, which is just really a small indication of how many lives he touched. But I know he would want us all to leave here today and to finish strong. He would want us to live every day to the fullest. He would want us to make a difference every single day. He'd want us to be positive, as the sign over his doorknob said. And so let's take a moment and just pray together. If you're here today and you just feel a tug in your heart, maybe there's an emptiness in your life that you've been trying to fill, maybe with stuff, maybe with a title. I just want to tell you, I think Keith would say to us, the only way to fill that void is a personal relationship with Jesus. To know that he died on the cross for your sin. And as he put on the cross, Christ died for Keith. I think today you can personalize it and say Christ died for you. And I believe the Bible teaches that if we ask him to forgive us and to come into our life, he will honor that. I hope on the other side, I hope to see every face here on that other side at that reunion, because every single person has trusted Christ as their Savior. Father, again, thank you, Lord. I thank you for each one that's here, and I know we're here to remember Keith and to support the family. But I believe you brought us here today just to remind us that life is short, death is certain, eternity is sure. And God, I pray that all of us leave here today with a personal relationship with Jesus. Help us to join together and just love on Patty and family and pray for them every single day. So Father, just give us safety as we leave here today and grant us the wisdom just to live one day at a time and to really make every day count. In Jesus' name. Amen. By the way, the service will be put up on YouTube in the near future. And so if you know of somebody who was not here, hopefully that'll be a way that they can participate and be a part of that. And so again, we appreciate you being here. I know it means a lot to Patty and the family. Thank you so much.